I'm going to go ahead and get into this message today. You guys excited about this? Say it with me. Give me this mountain. So in part one, a couple of weeks ago, I gave you these verses. And I want to go back to these verses again, especially for people who are new. This is your first time in our church. This message is going to change your life. I truly believe that. The story, just the backstory here, is a story that everyone should be familiar with. There's multiple movies out that most people have seen. It's a story of Israel when they were in slavery for many years, and God came to Moses and said, I'm getting ready to deliver my people. I'm going to bring them into a promised land. And Moses goes across the Red Sea, you know, the plagues and everything like that on Pharaoh, and he goes across the Red Sea. And the Israelites, by the way, there's even archaeological evidence for all of this. I mean, many of these stories you see in the Bible are recorded also in secular history, not just biblical history. We're not making these things up. And so they come across, and they're in this place called the wilderness, and they're there. They weren't even supposed to be there. They're supposed to just go straight into the promised land, but they ended up there for 40 years because in Numbers chapter 13, when Joshua and Caleb were two of the 12 spies, Moses sent spies into the promised land, and they came back, and 10 of the spies said, yeah, man, it's a great promised land, just like God said, but there are giants in that land. We could never inherit this territory. And Joshua and Caleb said, you know, basically, God is with us. We can do this with ease. Let's go for it. And it says that the evil report prevailed and that the nation sided with the 10 spies and said, we can't do it. And I see that today with so many people. There is a can't do it spirit in a lot of people and a lot of families and a lot of towns, especially in small towns. There's a can't do kind of attitude in too many people. And oftentimes the difference between doing something big with your life and doing something little with your life is just the kind of attitude that you have. And so I pick up in this story, this is 40 years later. Here's what happens. All of the people that had that attitude of unbelief ended up dying. An entire generation died, and they buried them in the wilderness. But these two guys, Joshua and Caleb, made it out alive. And they're basically standing there with the children of that previous generation. And Joshua and Caleb, after they're inheriting this promised land, Caleb is having a conversation with Joshua, and this is what he says. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to explore the land of Canaan. I returned and I gave an honest report, but my brothers who went with me frightened the people from entering the promised land. For my part, I wholeheartedly followed the Lord. Sounds a little self-righteous there, but he was confident. So that day, Moses solemnly promised me. He's thinking back 40 years ago. That day, Moses made me a promise. Moses promised me that the land of Canaan in which you were just walking will be your grant of land, and that you were just walking, because remember, he was one of the spies that went and checked it out. So Moses had said to him, that land that you were just walking on, he said, will be for your descendants forever because you wholeheartedly followed the Lord my God. Now, as you can see, the Lord has kept me. This is what Caleb is saying to Joshua now. Now, as you can see, the Lord has kept me alive and well for these 40 years. For 45 years since Moses made the promise, even while Israel wandered in the wilderness, God kept me alive. It's amazing. Today, I'm 85 years old. And look at this. I am strong. I am as strong now as I was. I am as strong now as I was when Moses sent me. Say this with me right now. I am strong. Say it again. I am strong. That's hard for a lot of people to say. Today we're going to talk about your words, because what you say out of your mouth is making a bigger difference in your life than maybe you've ever known before. He says, so give me the hill country the Lord has promised me. In the King James, it says this. Now, therefore, give me this mountain. That's where this comes from. Give me this mountain where the Lord spoke, wherever the Lord spoke that day. And he goes down a little bit more. He says, if the Lord is with me, I will drive them out of the land just as the Lord has said. A mountain, just to recap, represents a bold future. So when I say, give me that mountain, say it again, give me that mountain. You have to replace mountain, whatever it is, with whatever it is you would like to have in your life. God wants you to be filled with hope. God wants you to have a dream. Some people will tell you, don't dream too big. Don't get your hopes up. Some people tell me as a pastor, don't preach too good. Don't get people's hopes up too high because you'll put people in disillusionment and you'll make people aim for things and you'll fill their lives with discouragement because you'll tell them they can have things that they can't have. Well, my God, I'm not going to tell you to aim for nothing. If that's the case, let someone else do that job. I'm a big dreamer and I believe that God has a big dream for everyone. I believe that God has a mountain for every person. I don't know what your mountain is right now, but it's something that's so enormous you feel like you could never get there. But if you can just start to believe that God could give you that mountain, and if you could say out of your mouth, God, give me that mountain. You know, some people even have a hard time praying to God big prayers. And you got to get it out of your mouth and say, God, I'm gonna go for a big life. I'm going to go for a full life. I'm going to go for a happy life. I'm going to go for a life of fulfillment. I'm going to make a difference with my life. And you have to outlast the naysayers. In the story, Joshua and Caleb had all these negative people convincing everyone to believe in them that they couldn't have what God had promised. But Joshua and Caleb outlasted the negative naysayers and they held on to a promise. Some of you are trying to outlast the naysayers in your people group, in your circle, in your family. Not to discredit anybody's family, you know, but some of you are the first in your family to enter into like a life of faith. And you're trying to turn a Titanic of negativity around. And you don't want to be self-righteous. You don't want to walk in here and go, quit saying those negative things. People will get so mad at you and they'll never come to church if you're coming down on them all the time. But God has chosen you to get things turned around. You have to be careful because that voodoo will get on you. And it is a dark world out there. If you've noticed me, I hardly post on Facebook anymore. And I noticed the other day that I've been thrown out of the algorithms. And sometimes my posts don't even show up. You know how that works, right? Facebook rewards you if you're a good Facebooker. And they let people see your stuff if you do stuff all the time. And I'm so done. I know I can't be done with Facebook because it's around to stay. All the experts say that. But there's so much negativity on Facebook. I find myself scrolling, even some of you. I'm like, oh God, why is he saying that? Scroll, 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 scroll. And then I run into people. Do you see what so-and-so said? Don't tell me. I don't want that garbage in my head. You know, and I'm not trying to make anybody mad right now. You know, you want me to go delete some stuff? Yes. Yes. Negativity. The world is full of negativity. It's everywhere. And for you to be positive is a very difficult thing. I think it's a miracle that Caleb lasted 40 years and didn't die in the wilderness with all the other death around him. You know, one of the war tactics was, as a form of punishment, they would actually strap a dead body to a live person and let the dead rotting body rot through the live person, a slow, painful death. And I think that if you connect yourself to the wrong people, it will rot through your life. If you read the wrong stuff, it will rot through your life. The Bible says, don't be deceived. Evil communication corrupts good character. I think that's 1 Corinthians 14:33, maybe. It just came to me. somebody check it up. It says, evil communication corrupts good character. That's what it says in the King James. And so we're talking this story of a guy who says, I want a mountain. I believe that God has a mountain for me. And I said a couple of weeks ago that it starts in your mind. And I said that just a couple of things I'll throw on the screen, that victory starts in the mind. And then I said the biggest battle you ever face is the battle for your mind. And you have to conquer your mind before you can conquer your mountain. And if you want to have a better life, then you got to fix what's going on inside of here. You could go back and watch that sermon on our YouTube channel. I even gave you, I suggested a three-step mind shift. And I said, here's how you change your mind. You got to correct your image of God. You have to reject your past self-image, and you have to assert your new self-image. And I told you how to do that. So today, you know, as we go back to that text in the Bible about Caleb, God had promised Israel a new life when they were in slavery, a new life of total victory. And God is promising all of you that today. Well, how can you be sure of that? Because the Bible is full of promises, and those promises are for you. And the Bible says that every promise of God is yes and amen. God, is this for me? Yes and amen. Is this one for me? Yes and amen. The promise is yes. The problem is not with God. The problem is, will you believe God? Will you believe God, right? And so God has promised, but most people are settling in the wilderness. Bishop T.D. Jakes has said, and I've quoted it so many times, it's probably my favorite T.D. Jakes quote. He said, we got all these promises, we've got all this power. And he said, but we're not cashing in on it. He said, it's like we're starving to death in a grocery store. And that's what I see with a lot of Christians today. We're living in the wilderness when Jesus died on a cross to bring us into the promised land. That he who is rich became poor so that in his poverty we might become rich. And God has this great life that he wants to give us, but we're outside of the promise. This is, so people are settling. One of the best quotes I've ever read in my life, I read this morning. Beware the lollipop of mediocrity. Lick it once and you'll suck forever. Brian Wilson from the Beach Boys. Is that a good quote or what? Not for the Seeker Service. But mediocrity, settling. There's so many people that are settling for a lower life than the one that God has for you. And I hope I make you uncomfortable today. So you're settling for a version of yourself that is far less than what you know you can become. It's easy to be lazy and to settle with a lower version of yourself. It's easy to settle with a lower version of your marriage. It's easy to settle with a lower career. It's easy to settle with less money. It's easy to settle and become lazy. But we don't want to do that. What kind of life do you really want to have? I'm asking you today in the balcony and down here, what kind of life do you really want to have? What kind of relationships do you want to have? What kind of marriage? What kind of family? What kind of relationship do you want with your kids? What do you want your kids to do with their life? What kind of career would you like to have? What kind of money would you like to have? Do you want to die with $200,000 in debts? Or do you want to die leaving an inheritance to your children and your children's children? All of these things are promised in the Bible. The Bible talks about a righteous man leaving an inheritance to his children's children. You go, well, you're 45. You're thinking about inheritance now. I'm only 25. I'm not thinking about it. I'm just going to tell you from 45, you should start thinking about it at 25. But you probably won't think about it until you're 45 because you won't hear the 45-year-old telling you that because I didn't hear the 45 guy telling me that. Got it? Yep. Just tripped you all up. Are you happy? Do you have the kind of life? God said to me the other day, I was kind of stressed out. He says, if I could give you anything, what could I give you? And I was like, time. I said, time. And it was almost like God was like, okay, explain. And I said, quality time. If you're going to bless me today, this month, this week, this year, bless me with quality time. I'm starting to understand the value. I have a coaching client that told me a while back, I only have 3 hours a night with my wife. We're not getting enough time. I was like, 3 hours? 3 hours with some one person. And your devices are all turned off, and you're actually looking at the color of their eyes, and you're experiencing it. I said, God, when my daughter walks into my house, and her energy is so off the charts, like, bah, 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 bah. I mean, just energy, everything just shuts down, and she just sucks the energy, and just comes in like this nuclear powerhouse coming into the house. And I don't want to be working when my daughter comes in the house. And when the kids come running through the house going, Pops, I want to put everything down, I want to look at them, I want to listen to them, I want to see the wonder of the moment. You got what I'm saying? And so I'm taking charge of my own life to increase the quality of my time. I'm learning how to burst and be on when I'm on so that I can be completely off when I'm off and enjoy the things that really matter. Because really, when it's all done, money doesn't matter, things don't matter. It's quality time. Give me a half an hour with God where I'm completely focused on Him. I'll take that over 2 or 3 hours of multitasking and prayer. quality time. And so I'm saying to myself, what kind of life do I want? I'm going to take charge and I'm going to get that kind of life. Listen, when you stop dreaming, well, let me just say this. Caleb said to himself, I will never settle with anything less than what God has promised me. So you have to ask yourself, where have you settled? And when you should have held on to the idea of something impossible, extraordinary, never been done before, something that gave you chills when you first had the idea. When did you settle? When did you let that dream go? When did you stop dreaming big? You know, and to get your mountain, you have to stop sabotaging your own life. That's what this message is about today. You have to stop sabotaging your own future. How are we doing this? We sabotage our future with our words. We sabotage our future with our words. The problem is never with God. He's limitless. God is limitless. The problem is never with someone who hates you. Somebody goes, oh man, I've just had so many disadvantages in life. You know, this person doesn't like me and that person, I've had this circumstance and it just seems like everything's always against me. Nothing against you can keep you from getting into your future. The only person that can keep you from getting into a better future is you. Listen, that sounds cliche, but it is the biggest truth maybe I've learned to 45. It is you. The problem, we always want to blame somebody else. If you blame someone else, then you have no control over the change. But if you take responsibility, you can change your life today. You can start to change your life today. That was good. Right? So I want to say this, you know, you have to stop your runaway mouth, or it will destroy you. You have to stop thinking and saying dumb, negative, and worthless ideas. You have to stop repeating. You have to stop saying things like, oh God, you got a flat tire in your car, and then your dog ran away, and you go home, you go, oh, when it rains, it pours. What's next? Stop saying that stuff. You're opening wide open the door for more bad things to happen in your life. You have to stop saying, you have to control what you're saying with everything that's attached to I can't, I don't, I'm not. You have to stop saying those things about yourself. Can you do that? Say yes. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you will, but you can. I don't know if I will, but I can. I told Emily, I really want to put this into practice because I have been allowing myself to let negativity come out of my mouth, and I have been destroying my own life with negative words in the last few years. And I had the epiphany. I said, you know what? I'm going to take this to the church and I'm going to give it to them too. Because I bet lots of other people are struggling with this as well. Look at some verses on this. Let me back it up in scripture. Some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise bring healing. Whoa. Some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise bring healing. Just think about your relationships. Are you throwing cutting remarks into your relationships? You should close your mouth. If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say. That's what my mom always taught me. If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. Sometimes just closing your mouth could heal so much. Just stop talking until you can get control of your mouth. Just somebody goes, my God, you don't talk anymore. I know. I don't have anything good to say. I'm trying to fix my thoughts in here. I will talk in about 2 months once I'm done reprogramming. Come on, right? Come on. You know, it's so true. So we have to get control of the runaway mouth. So some people make cutting remarks, but the words of the wise bring healing. That's Proverbs 12:18. Look at this one. The tongue has the power of life and death. Those who love it will eat its fruit. We've heard this so many times. I almost didn't use this verse because people don't hear it anymore because it has become cliche. But is it true? The tongue, inside of the tongue, is the power of life and death. The power of life and death. You can kill or heal with words. Isn't that amazing? Honestly, I think I could spend the rest of my life learning about God. And when I die, I think one of the biggest mysteries will ever be how God creates with words. I don't understand. I can speak to the carpets and go, carpets turn green, carpets turn green, carpets turn green. And maybe they're, wouldn't it be cool if that happened? God can do that. God can do that. In the very beginning, God created with words. I'm going to save that for a minute. The power of life and death is in the tongue. I was thinking about this doing this exercise, but I wouldn't do it because it would be so cruel. But let's just say we were to take Sean and we were to go, I want Sean to close his eyes. Actually, what if I told Sean to go outside and I'm not going to tell him what's going on. And I said, when Sean comes back in, I want everyone to grit your teeth and think the most negative thoughts you've ever thought towards another human being, towards Sean. I want you to stare him down and I want him to feel it for the rest of the service. Do you think Sean would feel it? Yeah, he would. Sean would go home being like, man, dude, the church just straight up shut me down this morning. Like, curb stomped my brain this morning, right? And but on the other hand, if I told Sean to go out, I want everybody to think the greatest thoughts you've ever thought. I want you to think millions of dollars. I want you to think greatest relationships. I want you to think straight up happiest smile on his face, all of his dreams coming true, everything happening. Would Sean feel that? Yeah. Most definitely. Your thoughts, your words, what you think and what you say over your life and situations is making a difference. But we want to blame everyone else. We have to start with us. I can't fix what other people are saying about me. I can't fix sometimes circumstances that are coming into my life. I can fix me. And I can just go ahead and happen, whatever's going to happen. But right now, I'm starting right here and I'm working out. And I'm going to change everything in my world. Watch it happen in the next 90 days. Now look. The one who guards his mouth, thinking before he speaks, protects his life. The one who opens his lips wide and chatters without thinking comes to ruin. That's Proverbs. Look at this one. Do not use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful. Let everything you say be good and helpful. There it is. If you can't say something nice, don't say it, because the Bible says, let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. And then this one here. Indeed, we all make many mistakes, don't we? Yes. There should have been a huge amen. I know you guys. We all make many mistakes. For if we, and the one who laughs the loudest makes the biggest mistakes. For, was that Emily? Oh, who was that? It was probably a guest. It was a first-time guest. I'm never coming back there. But look. Indeed, we all make mistakes, for if we could control our tongues, if we could, we would be perfect. Wow. Just control your tongue, and you could be perfect. Think about how much your life is. You can't even enter into an affair if you don't use your tongue. Think about how you what you say. When I say tongue, I'm also talking your fingers and texting now. That's the way the Bible will be updated right now. In the next version, everything with words is also going to be text and stuff like that too. In the modern 2017 version. We can control our tongues. We can control our communication. We can control our language. We can control our language. However we're communicating, if we can control what's coming out of us being expressed, then we would be perfect and could also control ourselves in every other way. We can make a large horse go wherever it wants, wherever we want it, by means of a small bit in its mouth. And a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. In the same way, the tongue is a small thing and makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set the forest ablaze. Amen. Kristen, if you can't say anything nice, say something sarcastic. That's great, Kristen. I know that's your philosophy because you do it really well. Okay. That was fun. Where's Kristen? I love my assistant, Kristen. She's great. The hardest change for many people to make is to change what you're saying. Would you agree with that? Is this hitting home? Are you guys struggling with this? I am struggling with this. Kenneth Copeland and Gloria Copeland, years ago, they made a covenant with each other and said, we're going to watch each other's words for like a year straight. And we're going to hammer each other until we're finally saying good things. And we're going to stop. We're literally going to stop ourselves from saying negative things. I just ordered this thing called the 5-Minute Journal. I encourage everybody to go to Amazon and buy that, the 5-Minute Journal. And it actually leads you every day. It's just 5 minutes just in the morning and at night. And it leads you to say things like, what are 3 great things that happened today? Say 3 things about yourself. I am strong. I am beautiful. Whatever it is, you know, about yourself. And then it says, go read it yourself. But the whole idea is I want to train myself. I'm still trying to train myself to be in gratitude most of the time. I'm trying to train myself to think in groups of 3 good things happening in my life. So I was on the motorcycle yesterday. I was like, what am I thankful for? I'm going down the Blue Ridge Parkway. I'm like, I'm thankful that my wife loves to ride the motorcycle. And she's on the back, and every once in a while, she stabs my side and makes us almost wreck. I'm thankful that my wife is holding my ice-cold coffee right now. I know she's mad. I'm even more thankful for that little snappy attitude she has sometimes. Knowing that she's frustrated carrying the coffee, it made me feel so powerful and awesome. And it was just fun. And then I was like, just little things. I was like, I'm thankful for the Blue Ridge Mountains, you know? And then last night at the wedding, I got to talk to Daniel, Gail, and Laura. And she's talking about doing the Appalachian Trail. And I said, oh, you're going to do the Appalachian Trail? I watched her energy just go whoosh straight up when she started talking about the Appalachian Trail. I was thankful for that burst of energy that I felt from somebody excited about something. See, when you're more thankful, when you're thankful for just the weather shifted and it's warm outside, or whatever it might be, something you're seeing, you train yourself to speak positive, to think positive. This is not easy for most people to do. But let me tell you this. Faith and fear are both forces. Maybe you've heard this before. Faith puts confidence in God and it causes God to move. Fear puts confidence in Satan and causes Satan to move. Remember when Job said, the thing I feared has come upon me. When you fear something, you empower it to attack you. When you have faith in God, you empower him to bless you. To locate whether you're in fear or faith, listen to a person's words. Because what's out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. And the enemy and God both locate you by your words. So if you change your words, you change your life. And so I'm going to tell you how to make 3 speech corrections today. If you're writing notes, definitely write these down. You really should at least write down each week. I speak very clearly every Sunday. I always give you a crystal clear objective and crystal clear rationale. And if you just write those down and you look at them at the end of a year, you'll be able to preach my sermons over to yourself and get it again. But I believe that every person can take the mountain or the big dream item by making 3 speech corrections. We've got to correct our speech, our language. We've got to get control of the runaway train. And the first correction you have to make is this one here. Amplify possibilities instead of problems. Amplify possibilities instead of problems. It is such a waste of life for you to amplify your problems. How many of you are really good at this? Thanks, man. Thanks for the honesty, you guys. Everybody else is totally straight up lying. But anyway, we have some truth tellers in here. No, maybe some of you guys aren't. But I'm one of the worst in the room right here, so this one's going to be hard for me to preach without feeling like a hypocrite. Oh, there's so much. You just don't understand. You know, so much happening. Emily's arm's been bothering her, and then my wrist was hurting. And her and I were like, my arm, but my wrist. I've got to type. Well, I've got to run. We're just going back and forth over who's injured more. Come on, guys, right? It's unhealthy. It's unhealthy to do that unless you're getting some fun out of it in some way. Some people are overly trained at amplifying problems. We call them drama queens. And there are drama kings, too. Drama princes, you know. They can tell you 10 reasons why no and 0 reasons why yes. They are really good at calculating risks, but they're terrible about seeing the reward. They are now-sighted. They are not future-sighted. They cannot see where they're going. They can only see where they've been. And that's very dangerous. And they're not just destroying themselves. They're destroying everyone around them. Look at the text again. But my brothers who went with me frightened the people from entering the promised land. For my part, I wholeheartedly followed the Lord. My brothers who went with me. One negative person can ruin it for 10 or 20, 30 people. Honestly, negative words are worse than the flu. And you have to be so careful. I haven't gotten the flu this winter, and I'm just so thankful for that. I mean, I'm not bragging. I'm very thankful for that. But this winter, and I'm not trying to say that, like, I didn't trust God. I did trust God. But, like, I didn't let people cough all over me like I normally do. Like, you start coughing, I'm just like, go home. And then we disinfect the whole entire house. and pray. You know, I've been extra careful to wash my hands. And, you know, I was in a coffee shop. I held my breath for like 4.5 minutes the other day while this girl was coughing nonstop. I was just like, and then I was like, you know, I remember holding my breath, and I remember seeing the germs in the I entered into the microscopic realm, and I saw them flying. And I was like, I just about to breathe, and I saw one more go by. I was like, I'm just gonna wait another 30 seconds, you know, and then I breathe. But so you have to fight hard to stay focused on possibilities. Caleb waged war with the good report. They came back, no, you don't understand. Caleb and Joshua tried to steal the people. We can do it. We can do it. We can do it. They waged war with the possibilities over the problems. Have you ever done that with people before? Oh, my life is so bad. Yeah, but this is going, no, you don't understand. Oh, my God. It's all, yeah, but what about this? One of the worst things you can ever do in life, if you want to like get your face punched in, is try to encourage a really, truly discouraged person. Try to be happy around a really depressed person. It's dangerous. You got to pace the moment, man. You can't just go in there full blast. You got to go where they are and try to bring them up. It's dangerous. You know, you just tell somebody to cheer up. You don't want to just like get in their face. You got to bring them up. But Caleb and Joshua were waging war with the negative people. And you have to train yourself to amplify possibilities. Do you agree with this? How many of you could use training in this? You know, you have to train yourself. So one of the ways you train yourself is that you regularly ask yourself, what is possible in my life if anything were possible? What is possible in my life if anything were possible? Is anything possible? Say yes really loud. Yes. In the balcony, say yes really loud. Yes. Oh, yeah. So now all glory to God who is able through his mighty power working in us to accomplish what? Yeah, I wanted you guys to read that. Infinitely more than we might ask or think. Well, what if I outdream God? You can't. You can't outdream God. He can do infinitely more than you're capable of thinking or asking. You're capable of thinking or asking. And I think really what that means is, well, God used me to save the whole world. Well, you don't really believe that. God's going to use you to save the whole world. But whatever you can think or ask, whatever you can get out of your mouth and say is what you truly believe. And God can do more than what you can think and ask. And so you have to ask yourself, what am I thinking and asking? And then God says, I can do infinitely more than that. Whatever you're thinking is and asking is what you're really believing God for. Whatever you're saying over and over and over in your life, I'm not talking like one time you go home from church and you go, you know what? I got a burst of faith right now. Someone's going to pay our house off. Come on, guys, right? Right? No, that's not going to move a mountain. But if you believe something like that, if you believe we're going to be debt free or we're going to be this or we're going to be that, and you just say it over and over and over and over and over, at some point you will enter into faith. You will shift all the way into that, and the likelihood of that happening is very possible. Can you say yes? You have to learn to say yes. Say it again. Yes. You have to learn to say yes. I mean, honestly, the movie Yes Man, it had some questionable content in it. But there are some people that just straight up can't say yes. Hey, would you like to do this? No. Would you think about how many times you say no? And I know it's so tough, especially when you have grandkids and kids. And they're all the time trying to use that against you. Well, Dad, I heard the sermon you preached on yes. Just say yes. Man, your life, I read an improv book by a lady from Harvard University, the greatest improv speaker, one of the most respected in the world. And she said one of the keys to being an improv speaker is that you start with any idea and you just keep saying yes to every new idea that comes. So you go, this idea comes, you say yes to it. And you go yes to this and you go yes to that and yes. And you just carry it where it goes saying yes. And one of the ways you become a better improv speaker is that you start to do that with your life. That she recommends that you wake up one day with nothing on the agenda and you just say yes to everything that comes about. The homeless man asks for money, you say yes. Somebody says, hey, text, you want to go to a movie? Sure. Somebody says, you want to buy my dinner? Yes. Come on, right? You just say yes. You guys are not feeling it, I know. Actually, yes, you are. I'm going to speak it into the atmosphere right now. You're feeling everything I'm saying. You cannot wait to walk out of this church and live a different life. You are ready to take action on this sermon like no sermon ever in your life. Am I right about that? Yep, that's right. Okay, so God is waiting for you to see the possibilities and say something audacious like, give me that mountain. God is waiting for you to say out loud with your mouth what you want to have in your life. So instead of saying, give me that mountain, what is it that God wants to give you? What is it that you'd like to see in your life? You should say it out loud. Give me this and give me this and give me this. So I said, I don't want to demand God like that. That's the way God works. Well, I hate to put pressure on God by praying. That's what he wants you to do. Put pressure on his power. He's not upset about that. He loves it when you make a demand on his power. Amen. Come on, man, right? Yes. That was a little old school, but another generation needs to hear this. Prayer puts a demand. Faith puts a demand on God's power. And faith and prayer, when you pray in faith, you're actually asking God to do what he already wants to do. And your prayers are not requests, they're prophecies. Oh, man. All right, so you gotta do that correction. The second correction you need to do is you need to talk yourself up instead of down. You gotta talk yourself up instead of down. Somebody put your finger on your chest right and say, hey you. You're good looking. You're powerful. You're smart. Yeah, see, I don't wanna overdo it. Look at what Joshua said. The Lord has kept me alive and well. Say this with me. I am alive. I am well. Say it again. I am alive. I am well. Say this. The Lord has kept me. I am alive. I am vibrant. I am energetic. I am happy. The Lord has kept me. See what I'm saying? You're not burnt out. You're not tired. You're not barely getting by. Look at what Caleb's confession was. The Lord has kept me. I am alive. I am well. If you woke up every day and just said those two, life would start to change. First thing in the morning, I'm alive. Thank God. The older you get, the more you get out of bed, you go, I'm alive, yes. And I'm well. And then he says, later on, he goes, I am as strong now as I was. Say this with me. I am strong. Say it again. I am strong. Stop saying I'm weak. Stop saying negative things about yourself. I can't hold it down that much longer. I can hold it together. I've got a bad memory. I've got a bad this. I do, you know, I'm not educated enough. Don't ever say a negative thing about yourself again after you leave church today. I wish I could just hypnotize everybody. As soon as you walk out, as soon as I clap my hands, everybody look. Boom! You walk out. Everybody's like, how you doing today? I'm powerful. I'm beautiful. Can you imagine how cultish we would look going all over the community? Hey, how's it going today? Oh, I don't know. We just had a good church service. How are you today? Feeling great. Feeling powerful. Looking beautiful. I am strong. I have biceps. I have triceps. Those are the only two muscles I know. I've been working them so hard. So my arm was hurting, but I have great wrists. I have powerful wrists. I love dumbbells. Okay. All right, so you guys following this? See, affirmations are very strong. Church people really resist affirmations because they go, well, I just don't want anybody brainwashing me. And I get that. But listen, God bless you. But listen. You're already brainwashed. Somebody brainwashed you. It could have been a parent, could have been an ex-boyfriend, girlfriend, spouse, somebody. Somebody has told you something about yourself over and over and over and over and over, and you don't realize it. They programmed you, and it just keeps running and running and running and running, and you keep saying it all the time over your life. You've got to break that program, and I'll tell you, those negative programs are not easy to change. So what do you got to do? You've got to start saying what God says about you. You have to take time to think about what you should be saying about yourself. So, I mean, I'm giving you so much right now. I hope you're writing some of this down, because here's the deal. What I would recommend to everyone, I do this on a regular basis. What are three disempowering beliefs I have right now about going forward in my life? And what are three disempowering beliefs I'm having right now? And I start to think, what am I thinking right now that's really bringing me down? Oh, it's this. Oh, it's this. Oh, it's this. Then you write the opposite empowering belief for that disempowering belief, and then you start saying it over and over and over and over and over. And never say you're not this or you're not that. Always say what you are. Always put it in positive form. So I think I told you the story when I first spoke at the Dream Center. I was scared out of my mind. I didn't want to go. I told Emily, I'm canceling the meeting. I'm not ready for this. I'm just a small town guy. That's all it is. My church likes me. I feel good there. Home field advantage. I'm not going there. And God spoke to me one day and said, if you don't change your attitude, you're going to be swallowed alive in that church. And he said, you need to change the way you're thinking. And then God spoke to me, and I wrote down the disempowering belief. The disempowering belief is, I've never spoken to that many people before, or whatever it might be, all that negative stuff. And then I wrote this down in my affirmations. I wrote down, God has opened this door. I've prepared all my life for this. I don't have to perform over my head to win big in this moment. I just have to be me. This is my moment. God has opened this door. I'm ready for this moment. They're going to love me. See what I'm saying? Like, I started saying those things over my life, and when I got there, they did. I've been four times now, you know. And so what I'm saying is, you've got to figure out what it is what are the disempowering beliefs you have going on in your life right now, and then start to say the opposite. Let me give you an example. Anybody struggling with sin in here? Well, here's the deal. Don't say, I'm a failure and I'll always be like this. Instead, say this. We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin, Romans 6:6. See what I'm saying? See, that's what the Bible says. You are no longer a slave to sin, and so that your old sinful selves have been crucified, and sin has lost its power. Start to say that instead. If you feel ugly, don't say, I'm ugly, my hair is ugly, my face is ugly, my arms are ugly, I'm fat, whatever it is. Instead, say this. So God created humans in his own image, Genesis 1:27. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. I am created in God's image. And then you're going to say maybe something from Psalms 139. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You're going to say the opposite of what you've been saying. Are you guys still with me, or are you checked out? Okay, when you feel like you're a nobody loser in this world, it doesn't matter if I live or die, I'm a worthless person. People think like that. Instead, you should say this. I am a chosen person. I am a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, I can show others the goodness of God. For he called me out of darkness and into his wonderful light. 1 Peter 2:9. You could do this over and over, saying what God says about you versus what somebody else told you to say about you. Come on, guys, right? Amen? Amplify possibilities instead of problems. Talk yourself up instead of down. It is kind of funny. I was gonna use Jimmy Floyd. Is Jimmy over there? Jimmy's like, what? Listen, man, Jimmy, I thought it was in my notes here, Jimmy. If I find it here, then I'll save it. I accidentally deleted this out of my notes, but I am not gonna forget to say it. So, just kidding. Jimmy Floyd is the number one reason the Redskins haven't been to a Super Bowl in recent years. Number one reason, man. I'm not even kidding you. Jimmy is the most passionate sports guy I've ever met in my life. One of your experiences in life before you die, probably right after going to the Grand Canyon or Machu Picchu, should be to watch a football Redskins game with Jimmy, right? Or a Virginia Tech game. I'll say to Jimmy, I think you guys got a good chance today. Oh, no, they're going to crush us. Oh, really? I'll be like, Jimmy, you guys are up by so many points. Oh, we're going to give it away. We always do. I'm like, Jimmy, stop. Your guys need you. You're killing it right now. And you know what? They did. Then he tells me, I told you. I was like, you did tell me. You told me, and it happened just as you said it. Come on, guys. Listen, man, if the skins only knew what Jimmy says, they would send someone down here to take him out. No, Jimmy, I'm just playing with you, Jimmy. I actually love listening to it. I almost don't want to change him because it's the funniest thing in the world. Listening to Jimmy talk about his team. When he's like, I'll call him up. He's like, leave me alone right now. Like when they're going really good, he doesn't want to talk. You know, he just goes silent when they're going really good. And anyway, it's just so funny. Okay, guys. So the last thing I want to say is the last correction to make is that you need to use God's words instead of just your own. Use God's words. I kind of gave you a taste of that, but this is more than just you confessing the right thing about your own life. Use God's words instead of just your own. This one's going to be super, 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 this is probably going to be like a really charismatic statement. And I'm going to use words like prophecy and prophet. And I'm just going to tell you, I know we have a lot of new people in the church and you're still checking us out and all that kind of stuff. I'm just going to tell you right now, I've been serving God for 27 years and I believe that God has given us the ability to speak on his behalf and to speak what he wants to say into a circumstance and to create it with his words. And I'm going to explain that. According to the law of first mention, what is the first thing God did in the Bible? Yeah, he sat there in his realm from his throne, and it says that he basically, God created, you know, time, space, and matter didn't exist, and then it did. Science has even proven you can go all the way back. If you reverse the Hubble telescope and all of its findings, and there's red motion, you take it backwards and reverse, the universe goes back. I know it's hard for us to believe because matter is so big, but it's so unbelievable. You take it all the way back that matter actually shrinks and shrinks and shrinks and shrinks and shrinks and shrinks until it's like everything in the entire universe that we have today goes. If you go all the way back, it's like a speck of dust on a pinhead, and you keep going back just a little bit more, it doesn't exist. And then it did. The universe had an origin, time, space, matter. It wasn't, and then it was. What's really cool is that's what the Bible says. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God said, and God spoke, and these things came into... You guys with me right now? Go read Genesis 1 today. It's amazing. You want to talk about words. Everything that exists today, God spoke it into existence. He spoke all the substance, all the matter. God spoke it into existence. This principle remains constant throughout the entire Bible. And you see God speaking. And whenever God speaks, things happen. And God can speak into your world and things will happen. But listen, he needs to borrow your voice. Amen? Yeah, I'm almost done, guys. It's 11:28. The restaurants aren't even open yet. That new one, every time I go to the new one down there, they open at like 6 o'clock at night or something like that. I'm like, come on, guys. Like, wake up and give us breakfast. I think they open at like 3 o'clock. I've tried to go several times and I'm like, forget it. I just give up. These people are too late nighters for me. But anyway, God wants to borrow your voice. Who wants to be a prophet? Nobody raises their hand. You know, how many of you would like to be Moses? We got one though. How many of you, if you had one chance to go back in the Bible, would love to be Moses standing in front of Pharaoh? Or Moses standing in front of the Red Sea and stretching out his staff and watching the water go. How many of you would like to do that? Yeah? Would that be cool? Yeah. Well, I believe that you are the prophet. Kenneth Copeland says this, you are the prophet over your own life. In other words, you can create the future with God's words in you, spoken into your circumstances, things can change. You go, you just don't understand, my marriage is so bad. Don't ever say that again. Say, my marriage is blessed. Say, my family is blessed. My kids are so far gone. Don't say that. My kids are completely out of control. Don't say that ever again. Say what you want to see in your kids. My God, are you one of those guys? Not always. I wish I was, but whenever I was, I lived the greatest times of my life when I had the most control over my mouth. And I'm determined to get control of my mouth again. I'm taking responsibility for everything bad happening in my life. Because nobody else has the power to change it. I do, and I start with me. And I'm starting to make some big changes in my life. How about you? Come on, guys. People say dumb, worthless, negative, and destructive things. Don't repeat those things. Say what God is saying. Remember Ezekiel in Ezekiel 37? He walks out. There's a valley of dry bones. All these dead people all over the place. Just bones. Bones broken off. You know, nothing's connected together. And God says to him, prophesy, Ezekiel, and say to the bones, come together right now over me. And so the bones started to come together. And then he says again, after the bones came together, there was skeletons standing there. And he says, prophesy again, Ezekiel, and say to the muscles and all the joints to come together and everything. And he prophesied again. And then he says, after they're standing there, the skin and everything is on the bodies, they're standing there, lifeless creatures. He said, prophesy one more time and prophesy to the wind and say, wind, come from the four corners of the earth and breathe on these slain that they may live again. And he says, and I watched, and the wind of God entered into them, and they were filled with the breath of God, and they stood up an army, a great army. And God says, you were in your graves, but I'm bringing you back to life. And this was an illustration of what God was going to do. As the prophet spoke God's words, man, I'm saying to you, there are dry bones situations in your life, in everyone in this room, and you possess the power to open your mouth and cause dead things to come back to life again. I expected a bigger response than that. That was a grand finale. I have nothing else. That's it. So you got to speak about the world you want to see, not the one that you're living right now. Speak about your words are taking you forward or backward. You want to go forward? Yes. Amen. I'm done. I will say this. I've had a couple of times in my life where prophecy has been like, somebody go, that's a coincidence. I say, no way, man. There's no way. I remember when I was in Uganda 10, 12 years ago now, and I was driving by the stadium, and I saw the stadium. I was doing open-air meetings. I drove by the stadium. I go, what is that building? And the guy who set the meetings up, he goes, that's the Nelson Mandela Stadium. I rolled the window down. It was a roll-down window. My wrist would have loved that, my new healed wrist. And rolled the window. That's probably where it happened. It was right there. I rolled it down so aggressively. I stuck my finger out the window, and I'm not kidding you. I pointed at the stadium, and I said, stadium, you can call me weird if you want. I said, I'm coming back to speak in there one day. I just said that, rolled the window back up. 10 years later, the event organizer calls me. He's like, you won't believe it. I'm like the cupbearer in Nehemiah's story. In Joseph's story. I've actually have influence with the guy that's leading 35,000 churches in this nation, and they're looking for somebody else to speak in the stadium. I mentioned your name. He checked out your stuff, and he wants to talk to you. This was 10 years later. I'd forgotten about it. He said, do you remember the prophecy you gave when you pointed at the stadium? I'm just going to say this. Why don't you just, I dare you, point at something and prophesy to it this week. Why don't you prophesy to something this week? I'll tell you one more story. I was doing a revival in Murfreesboro, North Carolina. Worship team, you guys can come. Or I don't know, maybe I'm just going to end this just like boom, just end it. But you can go ahead and come. So listen close. This is amazing. I'm in Murfreesboro, North Carolina years ago. This was a revival we did. It was only supposed to be three nights, a Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday morning, two nights in a day. And God moved so much, we extended it. We ended up going 97 nights in a row. You guys came to that. Mary, you came to that revival. No, you never made it. Okay, it's okay. Was anybody in this church ever go to that besides my wife and my kids? Who else? Is there a hand going up? Who? I can't see. Millie! I even had a friend from Michigan come all the way down in a camper, and he camped out. And he was a hardcore Catholic, you know, and he was video camera and everything going on. It was really wild, but I said to this lady one time, it was like midnight, she came forward, and listen, you can only just trust what I'm saying right now, but know that I value truth, and I don't like to exaggerate and lie about stories. I'm really big on facts. This lady comes up, she's the last one in line, it's like midnight, I was praying for all these people. She comes forward, I just literally looked at her, and I said, when you go home tonight, I didn't look to see if there's a ring on her finger, anything. I just said, when you go home tonight, get out of your car and go to the edge of your property line, and I want you to speak at your house and take authority over your house and prophesy that your marriage is going to be restored. I mean, that's really a bold thing to say, not even knowing if somebody's married. Come on, guys, right? Give me some props for that, right? Just like courage. I get a courage award for that, right? So when you're in that flow, though, you're just saying things, man. You're not even thinking. You're not scared. You're just doing. And I remember I said, speak to your home and say, I say that every spirit over this home, I just saw darkness. I saw a vision of darkness over home, is going right now, and the light of God is coming to my property, and my husband is going to serve God, and my family is coming back together. And she started crying, so I knew that, like, I was probably nailing it, you know? She was like, "Whoa!" I was like, calm down, woman, come here, calm down. It's going to be all right. You're going to kick me out. So I said to her, I said that to her, I am not even kidding you, about 2 o'clock in the afternoon the next day, I am in the pastor, Jim Gross, I'm in the pastor's office, and he receives a call. The lady says, I don't know if you remember, but I'm the lady who was there last night. I drove all the way from Virginia Beach to come to this. I was the last person. I was getting ready to leave. I didn't even want to stay anymore. I was so frustrated that I was the last one in the line. And she said, and that speaker said all those things to me, told me. She said, I got home about 2 o'clock in the morning. And she said, I walked out of my car just like he said. She said, I can't believe what the neighbors must have thought. And I yelled at my house like a crazy person. I said, darkness, get out of my home. My husband will serve God. My marriage is coming back together. All these different things. She said, I walked into the house. She said, I thought my husband was sleeping. She said, I got into bed real quietly, stuck my back towards him, laid down on the pillow. And he said, I'm still awake. She said, my husband starts crying in the bed. And said, I've been waiting. Oh. I've been waiting for you to get home. I want to tell you I'm sorry for everything I've done. And I have mocked you and all these. I want to give my life to God. I want our marriage to get back together. I'm not kidding you. I still know this woman today. This is like 15, 17 years later. I still know this woman today. She tells that story. 1 year later, I'm back for a reunion service in the same church. Reunion service. This big high-top van pulls in, rolls the window down, says, you remember me? I think so. I didn't. I was kind of trying to remember. I was like, kind of. She leaned back. She said, this is my husband. He was on his way to go become a deacon in the church. He was getting like ordained through some kind of ceremony to be a deacon in the church that they were attending. Still serving God a year later. That is the power. You know what a lot of people do? Is they speak negative about their spouses all the time, but you're never going to see things turned around like that. Maybe you should try what that woman tried tonight. Come on, guys, do something weird. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray over every person in this room right now, anybody that's going to watch on the internet, God, that you would heal us from saying dumb things, and that you would, that God, you would move in our lives, God, that you would put positive, futuristic terminology, phrases, ideas inside of us, and that we would have the courage to speak about where we're going, even when the whole world says the contrary. I thank you, God, that we are survivors, that we will outlast all the negativity around us, and that we will inherit great promises. I speak to every person from the young adult to the teenager, maybe to the young adult that's struggling to see any purpose and where they're at in life right now, that you would give them a dream today, this week, this month, this year. God, I speak to those who are, to the singles. I speak to the married people today, God. I speak to those who don't even know you right now and want a relationship with you. I pray today that you would truly change a life today, God. Change many lives today. I expect that to happen in Jesus' name. Amen. I want everybody to stand. And hey, listen, if you need prayer for something, please come forward. Our prayer team is going to be up here, and they're going to be available to pray for you. I'll be here as well. If you want to give your life to Christ this morning, you can come from the balcony. I'd love to introduce you to Jesus today. Otherwise, have an awesome day.